The next speaker is Hannah Wallach. She is a professor at University of Massachusetts Amherst in the computer science department, and she's one of the founders of Debian Women, Women in Debian. And she's going to be talking about statistical machine learning analysis of Debian mailing lists.
Thank you. So I'm going to use this microphone because I don't want to wear the other one, but I don't know what's going on with that. But if you can't hear me because I'm not very good at using the microphone, then tell me and I'll try and fix it. Okay, so thank you all for turning up. I'm Hannah, and I am going to be talking about statistical machine learning analysis of Debian mailing lists. I should probably give you a little disclaimer to start with, which is that when I submitted the idea for this talk, I thought this was going to be awesome, I was going to get a ton of analysis done before the conference, it was all going to be fantastic, I was going to have amazing results to present. Yeah, that went well. So, I have some preliminary results to present, and a lot of exciting things to tell you about, and a bunch of ideas for what I'm going to do next. And that's about it. So, who am I? Well, alright, so I'm Hannah, and I've done various things to do with Debian and GNOME over the years. For a while, I was one of the leaders of Debian Women until I got busy and sort of dropped off the face of the earth. I founded GNOME Women's Summer Outreach Program, was a workshop organizer for the Flosspoles Gender Study, and most excitingly, I am starting in September as an assistant professor at UMass Amherst. And this talk is really actually, so this talk is the first talk that I'm going to be giving that's sort of unifying my machine learning research with my free software interests. Okay, so what am I going to talk about? So I'm going to talk through several things today. I'm going to start off by telling you what my research is on, so what my research goal is, and how I actually try and achieve that goal, what my methodology is. And then I'm going to talk a little more specifically about document analysis and statistical topic models. Then I'm going to talk about analyzing Debian mailing lists using these techniques, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about what data sets I'm using and some sort of preliminary findings and results and the kinds of things that you should see more of within the next year or so. And then finally, I'm just going to talk about future research directions, specifically other kinds of models that I plan on applying to these kinds of data. All right, so what's my research goal and methodology? Well, this is it. So I'm going to read it to you. To develop new statistical models and computational tools for representing and analyzing large quantities of complex communication and collaboration data in order to better enable social scientists and technologists to advance the study of scientific and technological innovation. There's a serious and in there, sorry about that. So this is really what I do. I develop statistical models, I develop computational tools, and I use these models and tools to analyze really large quantities of data. And for the most part, I work with text data, but I also work with sort of social network data, graph-based data, that kind of stuff. But my primary research focus is on text data. And specifically, I'm interested in text data in terms of the role it plays as a communication and collaboration medium. And ultimately, the end goal in what I'm doing is to work with social scientists and other technologists to actually study the process of science and technological innovation. So how does innovation happen? How do we actually, you know, make new technology, make scientific discoveries and stuff like that? So why free software development communities? Well, there's been a ton of interest in the past 10 years or so in free software development communities. And there's all kinds of people interested in free software communities, from people in, you know, commercial bases, non-commercial, academia, of course. And there are many reasons why people are interested. Primarily, it's because free software development has these really complex technological, legal, and social structures. And this is really interesting. So you see a lot of kinds of, you know, I don't know, maybe companies or whatever that have on a much smaller scale, technological, legal, and social structures, but really, the free software community is kind of where this all really comes together on a massive scale. And for this reason, people are very interested in studying free software development communities. Furthermore, a lot of the collaboration that takes place is geographically distributed. The developers aren't working in the same office, they're not sitting across from each other. They're actually working, you know, across the world. And as a result, they're communicating with each other via the internet and stuff like that. despite this considerable interest, the organizational and social processes underlying collaborative free software development are still kind of unknown. I mean, there's been a lot of research in recent years studying this kind of stuff, but there's still a lot more to be found out. And this is a really great area of study for social and computer scientists. Obviously, social scientists are interested because of, you know, more of the legal and social structures, and computer scientists are interested because of the technical structures. So, when I'm talking about studying collaboration, what am I talking about? Well, this little quote here from, this is actually from an NSF brochure that I found lying around in the library being given away for free, and I picked it up thinking, oh, this is kind of entertaining. Maybe this will come in useful, and sure enough, it has. This little quote from this explaining what I mean by kind of products of collaboration and the kinds of data that I usually work with. So I'm just gonna read it to you. Scientific information is both the basic raw material for and one of the principal products of scientific research. Scientists find out what other scientists are accomplishing through journals, books, abstracts and indexes, bibliographies, and reviews. And that's great. There's been huge amounts of work in academia for the past many years studying these kinds of things that scientists produce when they're collaborating. And there's been lots of research on this, people analyzing patent data, people analyzing research papers. This is the kind of stuff that I've been doing for years. But the thing is, this is actually not what happens within the free software community. You know, we don't write these technical articles that are subject to peer review, that take a couple of years to appear, you know, that people then cite in other articles. We're not dealing with these kinds of collaboration structures. And so for this reason, studying free software is actually really interesting, because although it is, you know, technological community and there are products of collaboration, the products of collaboration are kind of different to what you find in the academic sciences. So why is false collaboration data interesting? Well, one of the most interesting things to me is that most of the data are publicly available. We've got mailing lists, we've got IRC channels, we've got commit messages, we've got bug reports, comments in source code, documentation, even key signing records of, you know, when one developer met another developer in person. There's huge amounts of data publicly available. And for the most part, particularly with the text-based data, these data aren't being used at all. People aren't actually analyzing the content of these actual collaboration data. People aren't looking at the content of mailing lists. They aren't looking at the content of IRC channels or commit messages and bug reports, you know, this kind of stuff. They're for the most part looking at how the people interact with each other via social networks and stuff like that. But there's much less emphasis on actually saying, okay, well, when these people are communicating with each other on a mailing list, what are they talking about and why are they talking about it? And so my goal is to use these data, these publicly available, primarily text data, to study the organizational and social processes underlying free software development. And what are the challenges? Well, there are actually some really big challenges in working with these kinds of data. So as I said before, people do a lot of studying of, you know, academic papers and patents and stuff like that. And that's fine, that works very well. And those data are actually really structured. You know, when you have an academic article, you know it's going to start with an abstract, then you know it's going to have an introduction, then you know it's going to have a background section, then you know it's going to have methods, then results, then conclusions, blah, 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 and so on. You know, you basically know what's going to be in there. Similarly with patents, you know that there are going to be claims, you know there's going to be an abstract, you know, all of this kind of stuff. We basically know the structure of these kinds of documents. And for that reason, it's pretty easy to kind of segment these things out, to do entity resolution and work out who the authors are. You know, people typically only publish under one name. It's pretty easy to work with these kinds of data. But that's not really what we have in the free software world. Instead, we've got much more informal communications, we've got much messier data, and often highly unstructured data. So for instance, developers might use an IRC nick on an IRC channel, and then their email address on a mailing list. And yet, in order to work out who's talking to whom when collaborating on some project, we have to actually perform some kind of automated resolution to map these things to each other. You know, there's no point in saying, okay, well, you know, Stargirl's talking about this and Hannah Wallach's talking about that, when in fact, Stargirl and Hannah Wallach are the same person. So there's challenges like that, things like entity resolution. Another challenge is the fact that IRC channels typically have multiple interleaved conversations. So I do a lot of work on analysis of text documents and analysis of conversations and stuff like that, and that's what I'm going to be talking about later on today. But it's actually not possible to perform that kind of analysis if you don't know what constitutes a conversation. So if I see a bunch of interleaved comments, which of these comments are actually people talking to each other, and which of these comments are actually two conversations taking place at the same time, but aren't actually related. And so therefore, in order to analyze IRC data, you have to solve the problem of conversational thread disentanglement, which has a terrible name, it's the most ridiculously long name, but conversational thread disentanglement, which is a complicated natural language processing problem. The other thing is that there can be a mixture of highly technical and off-topic discussion. You know, you have some people talking about, you know, packaging software, stuff like that, and some other people talking about what they had for dinner tonight. And these are both perfectly valid things to take place on an IRC channel, but when we're actually analyzing the way that free software developers communicate, we might want to separate out which things are highly technical discussion and actually relating to the, you know, whatever piece of software they're building, and which things are off topic. And then finally, conversation style is often very casual. So, you know, these data, they're not formal papers. They're not things that people have spent weeks and weeks writing and, you know, really looking into the language of. You know, these are just random comments that people are making on IRC or on mailing lists. They're not, you know, written in that same formal style as an academic paper. And so, in fact, before we can even develop models for answering social science questions about free software communities, we actually need to perform significant text analysis if we want to make use of these text data. So, how do I do this kind of stuff? Well, as I said before, the real modeling challenge is in aggregating and representing really large, messy data sets. We're not dealing with clean data, we're not dealing with small quantities of data, we're dealing with large amounts of really messy data. Also, handling data from sources with disparate emphases. So, for instance, you might have a bug report that's talking about the same thing as some post on a mailing list, but these are actually serving very different purposes and therefore may use very different language. Yet we still want to know that these are talking about the same thing and are the same kinds of conversation that are going on. And then finally, we want to be able to actually reason about these data and work out what's going on when people communicate and collaborate under uncertain information. We don't know for sure what people are talking about. All we know is literally the words that appear in these mailing list posts. We don't know for certain, you know, the underlying topics or anything like that. And yet we need to be able to efficiently reason even under uncertain information. So the framework that I use to do this is Bayesian latent variable models, or Bayesian hidden variable models. This is a really powerful and flexible modeling kind of framework. Very general. The key thing underlying it is that of Bayesian statistics. It's a lot of fun, but I'm not going to talk about the intricate details of it. If you want to find out more about Bayesian statistics, you can talk to me afterwards. This talk, I'm going to talk about one particular type of Bayesian latent variable model, and that's statistical topic models. So, I told you a bit about what I'm sort of trying to do and the kinds of data that I'm dealing with and the kinds of methodology that I'm using, mainly Bayesian latent variable models. And now I'm going to tell you a little bit about document analysis and actually statistical topic modeling, the particular modeling framework that I use on a daily basis. So, statistical topic modeling is, it's actually a set of models. There's many different models that fall into this framework. But statistical topic models all share three fundamental assumptions. And the three fundamental assumptions are as follows. Documents are assumed to have some kind of latent semantic structure. So what I mean by this is as follows. When I see a document, this document is about some topic, or some topics, plural. And yet what we actually see when we look at a document is simply a collection of words. We simply see, okay, this word was used, this word was used, this word was used. But as a human, when I read that document, I know, okay, you know, this document is about entertainment and it's about sport. Or, okay, this document is about, I don't know, bug trackers, that kind of thing. But all we actually see when we actually look at documents are collections of words. Nonetheless, we can assume that documents have some kind of semantic structure. They're talking about some kind of topics. Furthermore, the second assumption of statistical topic modeling is that we can infer topics from word-document co-occurrences. Okay, well, what do I mean by that? What I mean by that is that, as a human, when I look at a document and I see this collection of words, I know what the document's about. I can say, okay, all right, well, because the word, I don't know, Jennifer Aniston and Brad Pitt were used in this document, it's probably not about bug trackers. It's probably about entertainment. Similarly, you know, if I'm seeing words like subversion, SVN, CVS, I know it's probably about version control systems. So by looking at word document co-occurrences, by looking at which words are used in which documents, I can work out which topics are being used. And finally, the idea is that words are related to topics, and topics are related to documents. And again, what do I mean by that? Okay, well, I mean a document is about some particular topic. So, you know, a document might be about, I don't know, Jennifer Aniston and Brad Pitt getting back together. And that means the fact that this document is about these topics means the words like relationship, back together, breakup, Angelina Jolie are all going to be used in such a document. So, given these fundamental assumptions, and given some collection of documents, the goal of statistical topic modeling is to actually learn what topics are used in that data set. So which topics are represented in this particular data set in question. And then also to learn which topics are used in which document. So given any particular document in that data set, which subset of the topics that characterize the whole set of documents are used in this one particular document. And why topic models? Why don't we just literally count the occurrences of words in each document? Literally just sort of, you know, look at the number of times each word has been used in each document. And this is why. So when I was a young PhD student, I was working on this particular thing to do with this area of machine learning research called Gaussian processes. And I had this fantastic idea of something that I was going to do. I thought, oh, this is great. I know exactly what this is going to solve. It's going to be awesome. I did some Googling and I couldn't find anything about it, and I thought, well, this is great, nobody's done this before. So I spent 3 weeks working on this, and then I told a colleague of mine about this, and he said, oh, you know, you should totally check out the geostatistics literature, because they actually use Gaussian processes as well, but they call it Kriging, and they have this like largely different vocabulary, so you might want to actually look for some of those terms. Okay, great. Turns out what I was working on had been done before in the geostatistics community, but I simply didn't know because the overlap in vocabulary was relatively small. And so what I did here actually is I took a document about Kriging on the left, and I took a document about Gaussian processes on the right. Both of these are introductory documents, and I counted the number of times each word was used in each of these documents. And we can see that the overlap, these are ordered from most probable to least probable. So Kriging is used with, you know, the highest probability in this document on the left, then covariance, then mean, then estimate. On the right, we've got Gaussian, then regression, then covariance. There's not actually much overlap, and yet these documents are talking about the same thing. There's a small number of overlap words, namely covariance and matrix, but there's not that much overlap. And the advantage of statistical topic models is that they actually get around these problems. So long as there is some overlap in vocabulary, even if different terms are being used, these documents, we will be able to infer that these documents are actually talking about the same thing. And therefore, you know, if I were to, I don't know, search for stuff to do with Gaussian processes, some kind of search engine or something based on statistical modeling could also pull up a document about Kriging, even though the actual direct overlap is pretty small. Okay, so I said that topics were related to words. Well, what do I mean by that? Basically, what I mean is that a topic is a probability distribution over words. So here on this slide, I've got four different topics represented in four different colors. And each of these, four columns, and each of these topics is a probability distribution over all words in some vocabulary. And I've ordered the words within each topic from most probable to least probable. And so what we've got in this topic here on the left, we've got human genome, DNA, genetic genes. Okay, when we look at that collection of words, we can say, all right, well, this is probably a topic about genetics. That seems reasonable. Similarly, if we look at the next topic, we've got evolution, evolutionary species. All right, well, this is probably about evolution. And so on, you know, computer models, information, data, computers. This is probably about something to do with computing. So in some sense, the fact that, you know, the words human genome, DNA, and genetics have high probability in this column here on the left, this pink topic, this means that because these words have high probability, this topic is probably about genetics. We can sort of infer that from looking at these words. And so that's what I mean by a topic. I mean a specialized probability distribution over words. Okay, so how are topics and documents related? Well, the basic idea is that when I have some, so I said this before, and I guess, you know, I'll repeat it to hopefully make it a little clearer. When you have a document, you can basically assume that that document consists of some topics. So in this case, there's an article here. I'll just read you a little bit from it. How many genes does an organism need to survive? Last week at the genome meeting here, two genome researchers with radically different approaches presented complementary views of the basic genes needed for life. One research team, using computer analyses to compare known genomes, concluded that blah, 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 blah. So when we read this, we say, okay, well, it sounds like this is about genetics and evolution and computer analysis. And we can tell this from looking at the words in this document. And so one thing, what I've done over here is on the right-hand side of the screen, I've represented the degree to which each of those topics that were on the previous slide. So if we look at the previous slide, I have four topics: human genome, DNA, genetics, then this one about evolution, something about disease, and something about computers. For this particular document, I've got this little graph over there that shows how much each of those topics is represented in this document. And so, you know, the red topic, the ones to do with genetics, that occurs a lot. Like, this document is really about genetics. You know, there's a lot of stuff to do with genetics. The yellow topic, which is about evolution and stuff like that, is represented much less. And then we've also got the blue topic, which is about computational analysis. But this article isn't talking about diseases and stuff like that. So that green topic just doesn't occur at all. And what I've also done is I've also colored various different words to indicate what topic I believe they're from. So we've got words like genes, genomes, and genes, and sequences, and stuff like that, colored in red, because they're probably from that genetics topic. And words like computer, predictions, numbers, computational, colored in blue, because they're from the computational analysis topic. And so in this way, I'm sort of relating words to topics and topics to documents by saying, you know, a document has some document-specific distribution over topics, and that distribution over topics is then going to determine which words are used in this particular document. So how does this all fit together? Well, the way people actually sort of look at these kinds of things in the world of Bayesian latent variable models and statistical modeling and stuff like that is that they assume that some statistical process generated the observed data that we're dealing with. So in the case of Debian mailing lists, the observed data would be particular mailing list posts. In other words, we have a bunch of documents, they contain particular words, we want to analyze them and find out what topics are represented in the collection as a whole, but also in each particular document. And so in order to do this, we're going to assume that these documents were not generated by us sitting at our computers writing messages. We're going to assume that these documents were generated according to some statistical process. And then, given this statistical process, we can use the principles of statistical inference to invert that process and actually learn the things that we don't know, namely what topics are used in the collection as a whole and in particular documents. So I'm going to talk you through the particular generative process that corresponds to probably the most well-known statistical topic model. And this generative process basically explains how, if you have a set of documents, these documents could have been generated according to statistics. Okay, so in order to generate a collection of documents, we first generate a set of topics. And these set of topics, there might be 100 of them, 200 of them, 1,000 of them, whatever. I've got four over here, the same four I was looking at before. We're going to generate a set of these specialized probability distributions over words. And these topics basically say, what is this whole collection of documents about? So in general, what are all of these documents about? So this set of topics in some way describes the collection of documents. And so in this case, we've got, one topic about, genetics, one topic about evolution, one topic about disease, one topic about computers. So we're going to generate these topics. And it doesn't matter how we're going to generate those. In fact, you would generate them by drawing from a particular distribution. I'm not going to get into the math behind that. If you want to know the exact mathematical details, you can ask me afterwards or not, whatever. But we're going to assume that we're going to generate this set of topics. Having then generated this set of topics, we can then go and generate individual documents. And of course, you know, just to reiterate, real documents aren't generated like this, but we're going to assume this generative process so that we can then invert the whole thing using statistical inference and infer the things we want to know. Okay, so to generate a particular document, we start by generating a distribution over topics for that document. So here we're going to generate a document, we've generated a distribution over topics for it. This distribution says, okay, use the red topic with a fairly high probability, little bit of the yellow topic, and, you know, kind of a medium amount of the blue topic. Having done that, we can then run through and generate each word in the document as follows. In order to generate a word, we start by picking a topic from our distribution over topics. So here we've picked the red topic, which makes sense because, you know, this document assigns a higher probability to red topics than to the yellow or blue topics. Then having done that, we can actually go and take a look at the red topic and say, now let's generate a word from that topic. Let's pick a word. And in this way, we can run through and generate, given a document-specific distribution over topics, we can then run through and generate all of the words in this article. And what we end up with at the end is something like this. You know, so we've generated a set of documents in this particular way. I've colored in some of the words according to what topic they were generated from. And this is basically this underlying generative process that's assumed in order to then invert this using statistical inference. So at inference time, what do we want to do? Well, as I said before, for real data, you know, given a bunch of posts to Debian mailing lists or something, we don't know what the topics are that best characterize this data set. We haven't got a clue. We don't know. Furthermore, for each particular post, we don't know which topics were used in that post. And so what we have is something that basically looks like this. We have a collection of documents. We can see what words are in them. And we're going to assume that they were generated by some topics and some document-specific topic distributions. But we don't know what the contents of those topics are or what the contents of those document-specific topic distributions are. And so the goal then, with statistical inference, is to say, okay, given this collection of documents, let's learn all of these things. Let's learn all of these little question marks. So the way this works in practice, when we're doing statistical topic modeling, is as follows. I'm just going to run through. So this is like a really simple algorithm that actually, although it's simple and seems kind of hacky and heuristic, it's actually not at all hacky and heuristic, and there's some very nice mathematics behind it that show that if you do this, you will converge to the right, you know, the right point of the distribution and all that kind of stuff. This algorithm is called Gibbs sampling, and it's basically a technique for saying, okay, given a collection of documents, what are the topics that characterize the collection, and what are the topics used in each document? So what we do is we start by we say, for every single word in our collection of documents, let's just randomly guess a topic. So let's start by saying, and one of the things about this algorithm is that it assumes a fixed number of topics. So you would tell it at the start, okay, use 200 topics. That's the only thing you're going to tell it. You're simply going to tell it, use 200 topics, or use 350, or use 100, whatever. And there's various different ways to choose appropriate numbers of topics. Not going to get into that. If you want to know, ask me afterwards. But let's say we've assumed that we're going to use 100 topics. Then what we're going to do is we're going to run through every single word in the collection of documents, and for every single word, we're just going to randomly guess which topic generated which word. In other words, we're going to assign a number between 1 and 100 to every single word. We're just going to guess. Who cares? Doesn't matter. We have no information. We have no idea what's going on. So we're going to randomly guess which topic generated each word. Then given this set of guesses, once we've actually got a guess for every single word, we can estimate how many times each word is used in each topic, simply by counting the number of times each word of each type is assigned to each topic. And similarly, we can guess the document-specific topic distributions by counting the number of times each topic is used in each document. So, of course, because we've randomly initialized this thing by just guessing what topics each word comes from at random, our initial guesses about these distributions that we're interested in are going to look like junk. They're going to have a bunch of random words that are unrelated, you know, thrown into each topic. Each document is going to be about some complete junk number of, you know, some complete junk topics. You know, it's going to look ridiculous. But this is where it gets good. So we're then going to repeatedly refine the guess for each word. We're going to run through our data set some number of times and look at each word in turn. And every time we look at the word, we're going to say, okay, let's pretend we don't know what topic generated this word. that's what we're trying to work out. Let's say we don't know what topic generated this word. Let's pick a topic that's responsible for this word. And we're going to do that by choosing a topic with probability that's proportional to two things. And the two things that that probability is proportional to are the number of times each topic has been used in that particular document. So we're going to look at all the other words in that document. We're going to say, okay, well, how often has each of the other topics been used? And a topic that's been used many times in that document is going to have a higher probability than a topic that's hardly been used at all. And we're also going to say, so we're also going to trade off with the number of times that word has been assigned to that topic. So in all documents, how often has a word of that particular type? We're going to look at all other occurrences of that word, and we're going to say, how many times has another occurrence, you know, has the other occurrences of that word been assigned to this topic? And so topics that have been used to describe the same word in other documents many different times also have higher probability. And if we keep doing this, we keep repeatedly saying, okay, pretend we don't know what the topic is that generated this word, guess a topic according to this, you know, particular probabilistic framework that I've described, then if we do this enough times, we actually converge to a point where the distributions of words for each topic and the distribution over topics for each document are no longer random. They actually start to sort of describe something that makes sense. And if we look at the topics, you know, they will look like this kind of thing, where we have human, genome, DNA, genetics, words like that all together in a single topic, words like computer, models, and information in a different topic. Similarly, you know, we'll see that things like some topic that's about disease isn't used in this article, because it's not using words that are to do with diseases. And so if we repeatedly run through this very simple algorithm, what we go from is something that looks like this, where we haven't got a clue, to something that looks like this, where the topics, these specialized probability distributions over words, actually, you know, group related words together in a single topic. And similarly, you know, documents use particular topics that are talking about similar things. So that's how topic modeling works. People have been, I guess I didn't know, need to go back up in the slides because I had this one, but whatever. And so people have been doing this stuff for years for various different types of data. Primarily, however, newspaper articles. These things have been used to analyze New York Times articles. These things have been used to analyze, you know, articles from Science, the magazine, articles from the Neural Information Processing System conference. They're typically used to look at really structured academic kind of data. And so what I'm interested in doing is actually using these models to look at Debian mailing lists. And so now what I'm going to do is talk you through just some initial experiments that I ran. I'm going to tell you what I'm using in terms of data, and I'm going to show you some initial results of the kinds of topics that I'm finding when I actually run these kinds of things. Okay, so the initial data sets, I took several different mailing lists. In the end, I decided only to use Debian Project and Debian Women just as my starting point. And the reason why I chose these two, I chose Debian Women because it's probably the mailing list that I'm most familiar with. I chose Debian Project because it's got a huge number of messages on it and it covers a really wide range of topics. So I stripped all quoted text, which was painful. I had to use some horrible regular expression from Emacs. It took me an entire evening. There was much swearing. It was not at all a pleasant experience. But nonetheless, I stripped almost all quoted text and signatures because I don't want that to be sort of biasing the analysis. Then what I did was I looked at the Debian Project mailing list, which consists of 19,000 messages, and that's, I don't have any commas in that number. All right, but it's over a million words. So it's a lot of data, over a million words, maximum roughly 8,000 words per message. So the longest post, and this is with quoted text and signature strip, is 8,000 words. Okay. So there's a lot of data here. In contrast, Debian Women, 4,000 messages total, 200,000 words, and 1,500 words maximum per message. And I'd probably be willing to bet that either myself or Eric wrote that. So I thought I'd use these two mailing lists just to kind of, you know, see what's going on. So here are some topics. So I ran with 100 topics on both of these data sets separately, And these are just four topics. I just picked out four pretty much randomly. I basically went through and said, so one thing I didn't do is I didn't remove spam from these lists. And as a result, therefore, many of my topics were just spam. So that's one thing that I'm sort of dealing with at the moment, is actually just running it through Spam Assassin before I even start. Okay, so ignoring spam, I just picked some topics randomly from each of these two lists, and these are the kinds of things we see. So in Debian project, we see things like packages, install, apt, get, apt. Okay, these words are all kind of related to each other, and they're all kind of about packaging an app. That works. Then we see Ubuntu, Debian, patches, derivatives, long-term support. All right, those are kind of related. Yeah, okay, I can believe that people are talking about that. Then we see this, which is to do with the new maintainer process. So we've got NM, process, applicant, DAM, FD. Then at the end, we've got FTP master, queue, packages, upload, team. You know, it kind of makes sense that these are the kinds of topics that we're seeing on Debian project. Similarly, if we look at Debian women, here are four randomly chosen topics from Debian women. And we see women, men, female, male, man. Okay, not surprising. Website, page, site, work, Debian women. Well, this is kind of interesting because when we started Debian women, one of the things we put a lot of time into when we first started out was actually getting the website up and running. What did we actually want on there, you know, for people to actually look at when they search for Debian women? And so that's great that we're actually seeing this represented in one of the topics that this algorithm is discovering. We're also seeing this one over here, post-culture response, post-behavior. Again, not surprising, there was a lot of discussion in the early days about, you know, the way people responded to posts, the way people, you know, posted and behaved on mailing lists and stuff like that. And again, we're seeing that represented in the topics that are being discovered. And then also we're seeing stuff to do with the new maintainer process as well. Now, there are different words that are appearing in, you know, the top words in this topic, but nonetheless, because the emphasis of the mailing list is different. So although people are talking about the new maintainer process on both Debian Women and Debian Project, they're talking about it with different emphases. And so we're seeing slightly different words appearing in the top words of each topic. But this is really nice. It sort of is telling us that, yeah, we can get a sense of what these two lists are about by looking at these topics. And then once we've done this, we can do some other really cool stuff. So I took various different topics and I plotted them over time. So here we've got packages, package, Debian, maintainers, maintainer, upstream. You see this big peak around 2000, then it sort of dies off, and then there's another big sort of rising peak towards 2010. That's kind of interesting, all right. Here, this is to do with Debian developers, upload rights, people, DDs, voting rights, rights. These are the top words or phrases that appear in this topic. And we see that this topic is pretty constant and not really used at all until this massive peak somewhere around 2008. Okay, that's kind of cool too. That's telling us something about what people were discussing on Debian Project in, you know, 2008, 2009, that kind of thing. So here we've got discussion about the new maintainer process. Again, there was a big peak in 2000, sort of a peak somewhere around 2007, and then trailing off after that. Debian women. So this is a topic that was found actually not in the Debian women mailing list, but this topic was found in Debian project, and it's got a massive peak around 2005, which is when we were doing a lot of Debian women stuff, and the words in this topic are women, men, Debian women, men, and so on. So that's really nice that we can just simply look at this topic, look at this graph, and yes, it really is highlighting actual, you know, behavior of what actually happened in Debian at that point in time. So that's mainly what I wanted to show you with that. I've got a few points about future research directions. So one thing I'm kind of interested in is cross-language analysis, and again, a little picture and quote from this NSF brochure. I'm not going to bother reading the quote to you, but I kind of liked it. So cross-language analysis. Suppose we actually want to do this kind of thing across multiple languages. Suppose we want to say that rather than a topic being a specialized distribution over words, just in one language, suppose we want a topic to be a collection of distributions over words in multiple languages. So here we have like space, mission, launch, satellite, NASA, and spacecraft. And I don't actually know any of these other languages, but I'm sure some of you do. And you can see that the words in the other languages are also related to space and spacecraft and stuff like that. So even though we've got multiple different languages here, multiple different specialized distributions over words, they're still all talking about the same thing, but in different languages. Here's another example with poetry, literature, literary poems, poems. These are taken from Wikipedia, by the way. As in, like, we ran one of these models on Wikipedia. So in order to get these kinds of polylingual topics, you kind of need aligned documents. And there's two ways that you can do this. You can either have documents that are direct translations of each other, and that's great, that works very well. That's known as a fully parallel corpus. But the problem with that is that these direct translations are really expensive to produce, and they're relatively rare. But we actually did some really interesting work where we showed that you could, as well as defining a model that works on these kinds of data, we showed that you actually didn't need that many of these kind of aligned documents. You just need a few parallel glue documents. And less than 25% of the entire set is sufficient to obtain these kind of nicely aligned topics across multiple languages. So one thing I've been thinking about is, can we use documentation, things where we do have direct translations, where work has been done to actually translate stuff in multiple different languages, as glue documents for then simultaneously analyzing the content of mailing lists that are in different languages. So we don't have aligned posts on mailing lists, but we do have documentation which is aligned. Can we use this kind of thing in order to do this analysis? Okay, another thing I'm interested in is simultaneously finding groups of people and topics. So without any prior information, can we look at Debian Project and say, this group of people is working on something together, and these topics characterize what they're working on. And can we do this by simultaneously discovering groups of people and groups of topics? And the answer is yes, that thing can be done. And that was something that was done by my research group a few years ago. Actually not by me, by other people in the research group. So one of the things I'm interested in doing is applying those techniques to Debian mailing lists to actually say, without any prior knowledge, can we work out who's doing what within Debian and who they're communicating with and collaborating with? And this is a little picture that, actually this is all from the Enron email. We ran this on the Enron email dataset, which is publicly available. And you see really interesting groups of people popping out and particular things they're talking about. You kind of can't see it, but whatever. Anyway, that's it.
I'm done.
Thank you.
Questions?
Hi.
Yeah.
Can I? Does this work? Okay. I'm interested in the practical applications of this. Could this be used for spam filtering? Could this be used for spam filtering?
Maybe.
Viagra enlargement.
Use the microphone. I get it. Okay. Could it be useful for spam? The question was, what are the practical applications, and could this, for instance, be useful for spam filtering? Maybe for spam filtering, but to be honest, really simple, naive techniques work very well for spam filtering. So, yeah, maybe. More other applications that could be used for this is creating some kind of online browsing system for Debian mailing lists. So suppose I'm interested in browsing Debian mailing lists, and I, you know, put in some search keyword or something, and it pops up a bunch of topics that are relevant to this. Then what I could do is click on each of those topics, and it would show me which documents across all Debian mailing lists are related to that particular topic. So that kind of stuff. That would be very easy to do. And when I say very easy, I mean I'll tell somebody else how to do it.
Okay, hi. I had seen a similar talk like a couple of years ago at the Python conference, and the guy presenting it was actually analyzing the dynamics of threads in the mailing list.
Yep.
And it came out with quite interesting results, actually. For example, that when the benevolent dictator in the Python community intervenes in a thread, then the thread will stop it.
Yeah.
So it actually has authority, and it was able to like recognize the most authoritative persons in the community. I wonder if you could do something, I mean, if
absolutely.
It would be possible to do something in Debian, and it would be
absolutely.
Really useful.
And one thing you can look at is, do people, so it's one thing I'm really interested in as well is, do people's tone, does the language they use differ depending on who they're speaking to?
Yeah.
So, and that's something that has been well studied. That yes, you know, people use different language if they're talking with somebody who they perceive to be more authoritative than them, as opposed to somebody who they perceive as being less authoritative. And so yes, that's absolutely something you could study, and particularly on Debian mailing lists where there is blaming and other such stuff. I think it'd be great. Yeah, so yeah, good point.
Here we go.
I had a question, but first I'm going to say about the browsing or practical applications. You said that, I thought, well, maybe your mailer could send most of the mails in a list somewhere in a folder where you won't look at them, and then just put in your inbox the topics that you're interested
in. Right, exactly. That's a really good point.
That's not a question. My question was, you had some topics there, and then you had this one, men, something, other, women. And I noticed that in your word collection, there was men, women, women, men.
Okay, let me explain why. So what I'm doing is, you know how I said that every word, the algorithm works by running through, and every word, we guess a topic for it. And then we move on to the next word, we guess a topic for that word, and we repeatedly iterate through this. So as a post-processing step, when I was generating these, what I'm doing is I'm saying if two adjacent words have the same topic assigned to them, then I treat that as a phrase. And so what somebody's done is like men slash, I'm removing punctuation, so it'll be like men comma women, men slash women, you know, that kind of thing. That's all, this is just post-processing.
Hello, we want to make two questions. Is this an open project or free software project? We can look the source code somewhere.
Yes. So a couple points about that. I'm going to be here all week, and I'm perfectly happy to teach people how to code this stuff up. I have a really simple Python implementation of this somewhere that I help people do at some Summit Day a while ago, so that might be good to look at. The whole thing is available as part of the Mallet software package, which I guess I will be packaging for Debian sometime this week, because I promised to do it for the past 3 million years.
What is the math behind all these?
So we start with the Dirichlet prior of the document. It's Bayesian statistics, specifically using Dirichlet priors, Dirichlet multinomial distributions, Gibbs sampling, Markov chain Monte Carlo, that kind of stuff.
Question is about the pre-processing you do, or if you shouldn't do more pre-processing you do to remove the quotes, but shouldn't you remove like plural and singulars of the same word? Plurals and singulars.
No. And here's why. So I have a really good example for why you don't want to remove plurals and singulars of the same word. So if I have an article that's about apples, and if I have another article that's about apple, one of these is probably about fruit, and one of these is probably about computers. So the plural and singular there actually can have very different semantics. And so as a result, you don't want to do word stemming, because otherwise you're not going to see any of these patterns appearing. It's going to be lumping articles about computers together with articles about fruit. So that's why you don't want to do word stemming. As in terms of other pre-processing, yes, you want to remove stop words, so words like the, and of. In fact, with the particular variant of this stuff that I work with, you don't need to do that, because I did some cool math showing that if you do the right thing with Bayesian priors, then it does everything automatically. But yeah, you can remove stop words, you can remove punctuation, all of that kind of stuff. Yeah, I mean, the amount of pre-processing you do is kind of up to you, and depends on how lazy you are. I'm quite lazy.
So I've got a question about how you come up with the set of topics. I'm just sort of assuming that there may be sort of a Pareto distribution of topics that are interesting. And I'm wondering, initially, with one corpus, how sensitive the number of topics is in terms of clustering. And in particular, when you're looking at multiple corpora, especially IRC versus email and so on, is there a way that you can sort of get to an automatic clustering of topics that are interesting?
So a couple of points. Firstly, in this particular variant of the model, you specify the number of topics a priori. Now, if you specify too many topics, some of them just won't really be used. So if you specify like 500, only actually needs, you know, 100 to account for what's going on in this data set. It's only going to really use 100. So that's one point. Another point is that in terms of which topics are interesting, so I have another variant of this model called, which is known as a cluster-based topic model, that simultaneously clusters topics as well as learning them. So as well as learning which topics are used in which document, which words belong to which topics, it also clusters the topics into a number of clusters that it automatically determines. And so this, you can see that, you know, topics about like women, men, you know, that kind of thing, and like, I don't know, getting women's website and stuff like that, would probably be clustered together in the same cluster. So yeah, you can do that kind of stuff too.
Hello?
You seem to learn a number of fixed number of topics. How well can your method handle a new topic which appears?
Right. So there you would. I mean, okay. So there's two variants of this kind of model. You can use this version, which has a fixed number of topics, which uses a Dirichlet distribution. You can also use the non-parametric version, which uses a Dirichlet process prior and would automatically learn the number of topics. It's just it's slower, and so I wanted to run this fast, so I'm just using the fixed. But yeah, you could use a DP version and just automatically like generate new topics as needed.
I think we maybe only have time for one more question.
Could you use this to build an automatic flame start detector or troll detector or general idiot detector?
And then
when the alarm goes off, you set it.
This topic is really about something of content. This topic is not. And so what I could do then is I can go through, because there's only like 100 topics or whatever that I'm using, I can say, okay, all of these topics are about complete junk. You know, these are stuff that is just absolutely ridiculous. Then I can say, which documents use these those particular junk topics with a really high probability? Then I can look at the authors of those. And yeah. So yes, you could do something like that.
But what I was thinking was that you could, say you set off a troll alarm in a private email from a machine so that you couldn't really take offense.
You could probably do that.
And at the end of the year, you could send a wooden spoon to the person that has it myself to
do something. So this is actually, I know we're all kind of joking, but this is actually a research problem that, okay, good. This is actually a research problem that I'm really interested in. Automatically detecting flame wars, detecting when flaming is taking place, and doing this in a completely automated fashion. This is, I'm super interested. And it's a really tough problem, but yeah. Okay.
Cool, thank you very much, Anna.